again. I need to stop making these backing tracks that just go on forever and ever and ever, because the temptation is just to play forever and ever and ever over the top. Hi guys, how you doing? Nick Jennison, the Guitar Interactive GI Plus. It's Monday. We're doing the thing that we do on Mondays, which is hang out in a sweltering hot studio and talk about the guitar. I don't know what's going on here. It's not even the hottest day we've had so far in the UK, but for some reason, the building is really, really warm. So if you see little bits of hair blowing in a breeze coming from this direction and you hear a little bit of a white noise, that is my fan. Thank you so much for tuning in. We're doing the thing we do on Mondays, which is hang out and talk about the guitar. Today we are back on the electric guitar and we are discussing the use of suspended arpeggios in your guitar playing. Now this sounds like it's going to be an intimidating topic, but let me tell you right off the bat, this is something that guitar players of pretty much every level, from early intermediate up over, can get some use out of, because it's something we hear all the time. It's a sound you're probably very, very familiar with, but you may not know that you're familiar with it. So if you're sat going, I am not Mr. Mega Shredder, fear not, because the stuff here for you. Let me tell you as well, by the way, if you are Mr. or Miss Mega Shredder, there's stuff for you too. We're going to be talking about that as well. So, because we'd be remiss not to play some very, very fast stuff too, because this stuff lends itself to some really, really notey playing, but we don't need to play that stuff to get the best out of it. Anyway, listen, if you're a first-time viewer, because we've got some first-time viewers in the house, I want to welcome you. Thank you very much for coming on board. It is a pleasure to have you along. Thanks for joining us. Thanks for joining our growing community of guitar players who come along most or every Monday, hang out, talk about the guitar. It's a wonderful thing. If you've got stuff that you want to talk about, drop us a comment. We'd love to hear from you. We're going to be checking in with the comment section in just a second. And don't forget, if you have questions, we'll be answering them a little bit later on. Probably about the 45-minute mark, I would guess, give or take. But we're here for an hour, so, you know, we'll be answering questions in the interim. So if you've got a question, drop them in the comments. If you're a returning viewer, hey, it's great to have you back. Thank you so much for coming back. We do appreciate you guys. It would be very, very lonely without you. And we love your comments. We love seeing you guys play. We love seeing the results that you're getting from the lessons that we're doing here. It's fantastic. That's really what it's all about. So anyway, a couple of ways you can help us keep the lights on, metaphorically and literally, we're going for all purple today, is you can do the following. You can go to this URL down here where it says Get More Lessons. This is guitarinteractivemagazine.com/GI-plus. That is the word plus, P-L-U-S, where you can get more lessons from the likes of myself, from, from Tom Quayle, from Rick Graham, from Andy Wood, Andy James, Chris Buck, Michael Caswell, Giorgio Cerci, who else do we have? Don Alder, Manelli Jamal, there's so many, and the great Sam Bell. Sam's a pal. I always forget about Sam, and I really shouldn't, because Sam is... he's up there, man. He's one of the best guitar players I've ever met. Fabulous player. And we got some stuff from him, too. So anyway, listen, enough about that. Other things you can do if you want to help us out for free without paying a penny or even leaving the window that you're on, you can give us a thumbs up on whatever platform you're watching on. You can give us a heart emoji if you're watching on Facebook. You can share this with your guitar playing friends. We'd love to get this out to as many guitar players as we possibly can. And also, last but definitely not least, you can drop us a comment, because the algorithm loves comments, and more importantly, I love comments. Speaking of which, let's check in with our comment section and see how folks are getting on. PJ is the first in the house. Good evening, Nick and all. Thought I saw you, Nick, playing with Cat Stevens yesterday, then realised it must be your older doppelganger. I am here as, like, a generic hairy rock guitar player one. So, there's lots of us out there, especially if you've got a little bit of a forehead and a bit of a nose, and maybe a nose ring. I keep forgetting what side it's on. Maybe a nose ring. Beard, hair, I mean, let's be honest, it's not an original look, is it? But even still, so yeah, it wasn't me, but I'll take that gig if it's going. Marcin is in the house. Helen from blistering Poland. It's blistering in the UK too, man, so I don't know what's going on, man. Northern Europe, we are cooking right now. Big heat waves, and we are not prepared for it. Our American brothers and sisters are probably sat going, your temperatures are laughable. And they are, in the grand scheme of things, but our buildings are not meant for warmth. We are meant for cold climes, and our buildings keep heat in, which is why I've got my little fan on in the corner. Sarah Godslayer is tuning in from Italy, where I'm imagining it's also wonderful. I've just sent my album To a mastering studio in Italy, really over the moon to be signed off on that album. Let me tell you, right? That is my work done. I can get back to being a guitar player again, which is nice. Who else do we have in the house? David Yates is here. David, it is good to see you. We've got some more comments from David in a second. We're going to get to our comments from head office saying tonight we're focusing on the tonally often overlooked Sus2 and Sus4 arpeggios. For sure. It's such a distinctive sound tool to have, such a distinctive tool to have in your songwriting arsenal. What are some of your favorite songs that utilize the sound of the suspended chord? I want to know this from you guys. I have a favorite too, out of interest, because of course I do. My favorite one, lesser known track from the mid 90s. It's a Bon Jovi track called These Days, and it goes like this. Really simple, but I think it just caught me at the right time in my guitar playing development to go, oh, that's cool, I need to know what that is. So perhaps not the trendiest of choices, but I think it's great. But I want to know what your favorite Sus2 chord songs are. I'm expecting some U2, I'm expecting some Police, some Prince, maybe some Satriani. Loads of good stuff in there too. We'll see what you guys have got in store for us. But yeah, Craig Tom continues his world travels. This is hi to the worldwide community of guitar maniacs from Wales. Merrily Hybrid picking away on my Strat. Let us know whereabouts in Wales you are, man. Wales is a big country. A lovely, beautiful, beautiful place though, man. They've got some countryside, let me tell you. Timothy Appling is in the house. Timothy, it's good to see you. Thanks for coming. Always love to have you on board. Cranker Tom says, Purple Rain and Every Breath You Take use these chords. Sure do. They also use sometimes it's kind of lumped into the same thing, the add nine chord things. Not quite the same thing, but they do use them, absolutely. It's that kind of. So in Every Breath You Take, we've got the. Get to the ad nines there, but yes, absolutely 100% they're in there. Purple Rain's in there too. I'm not going to play Purple Rain. We've had copyright strikes from Prince's estate for songs that weren't Prince songs, so I'm definitely not going to play a song that is a Prince song, because we'll definitely get a copyright strike. Larry Warren is here. Hey there, how's everyone? Looking forward to the session today. I'm looking forward to it too, Larry. It's good to have you back. Timothy Appling. Oh, yes, we're getting some encouragement from Marcin to upload some stuff to YouTube. I totally agree, right? I'm going to echo the sentiment. We want to see your playing, man. Get it up on YouTube. Speaking of which, our friend Chris Brown is back in the house. We'll get to that in a second. Instagram megastar. I love seeing Chris's posts on Instagram. He's been a busy boy on Mondays and hasn't been able to join us too much recently, but we love seeing his posts. So listen, if you guys are posting stuff on Instagram or you're posting stuff on YouTube, let me know. Send it to me or tag me in it. I love to see it. Absolutely love to see it. Timothy Appling says... July, August, September are good for hibernating in the air conditioning and playing more guitar. In Florida, for sure. Florida is brutal in those months because it's humid as well. It's not even that dry desert heat. It's the humid closeness, which we're experiencing a tiny amount of now, but we haven't got any air conditioning, which is one of those things. PJs is exactly the same when I used to live in Singapore. I can only imagine. More great songs from, from Boston, More Than a Feeling, Free Falling by Tom Petty. For sure, we're going to do some songwriting experiments with this in a second. Pinball Wizard, The Who, starts with three Sus4s to open. Really obvious ones are things like Summer of 69, Crazy Little Thing Called Love, anything that uses this D shape, Breakfast at Tiffany's. Loads of them, absolutely tons of them. We got some gear questions from Steve McD asking about FRFR speakers to go with his new modeler and plugging into any old PA when taking out. So does FRFR really matter? We're going to start that up, Steve, because it's an important question. We're going to answer that in our Q&A session a little bit later on. So stick around. We will definitely get to that because it's a question that is close to my heart. Mark Crandless here. Mark, it's great to see you. Kim is watching from sunnier climes, whether it be the south of the country or somewhere near the equator. I never can tell. He's a well-traveled man. Kim, it's good to see you. Thanks for joining. I'll see you on the weekend, actually, funnily enough, because we've got a boot camp to run. Timothy Appling is here. Well, we said hi to Timothy Appling, but Timothy Appling's been practicing a lot more during the heat wave. Good thing in my opinion. Anytime you're practicing more, that's a good thing in my opinion too. Foghornish is here. It's good to see you, man. Our friend Chris Brown, who we mentioned earlier on, lovely to have you back on board, man. You're playing some fantastic stuff on Instagram, right? Keep tagging me in those posts because I love to see him. Absolutely love to see him. Who else do we have? We've got some discussion on modelers. We're just going to sidestep that because we'll get back to that in a minute. We have a first-time viewer from Andreas Kessenheimer. Apologies if I butchered that. I think I got it right. From Cologne in Germany. It's a beautiful part of a beautiful country, man. Really glad you came on board. Rory Lisbon is here. Rory, it's good to see you. Always fine insight from our friend Rory. Andreas Kessenheimer says first time here. I think it's the right lesson to start with. Hey, maybe if this is the right lesson reaching you at the right time, then we've won. Our friend Panu Papaxidis is here from Geneva. Good to have you on board. Mark McNish is here. Mark, good to see you. Working on chord progressions with some raking strums. Very interesting. Very interesting indeed. The puns begin with I am in suspense. More like suspended animation. Good evening, says Mike Seedorf. Mike, it's good to see you. David Yates says, that was cool, Nick. Thanks, man. I appreciate that. Very, very cool. Appreciate that. Number one fan, referring to my fan blowing on down here. My hair is too thick to move with mortal fans, but even still. Mustache Metal is here, and we've got some... Oh, no. Oh, no. What have we got here? What caused the stadium to be so hot? Because all the fans left in it. I'm bringing these sus jokes tonight. A moment of silence. Anyway... Anyway, a paler slash, that might be me. Hey, there you go. We got some comments about some great guitar players we're going to touch on in just a second. We got some stuff about FR. We will come back to all that stuff. But in the meantime, let's get stuck in with the meat of today's session. So first things first, we need to define some terms. So we're going to go to a clean sound. If you don't have your guitar, by the way, grab a guitar, because it's going to help. You're going to need a guitar for this. We're going to go to the close-up cam. Let's talk about what a Sus2 chord and a Sus4 chord is and what it isn't. So let's begin with... Hopefully you guys can hear that. It feels awfully quiet. Let me just find a clean sound that's working for me. I'll turn my monitors up. Let me know if you can hear that guitar okay. If it's a little quiet... I can always turn it up. There's our lovely big clean sound. Let's knock the delay off though, because that's a little bit annoying for the time being. That'll do for now. Okay, so real quick, let's start with some typical triad chords and arpeggio shapes. If we take our common old garden, bog standard C chord shape, let me just move this camera around this way a teeny tiny bit so we can see a little bit more clearly. We have a C chord shape down here. We've all played this a million times. If we take this portion of our C chord, C, E and G, move everything up one fret again, we get a three note E major chord. This gives us an E, a G sharp, and a B. Dead easy. So fret numbers very quickly, A string 7, D string 6, G string 4. Piece of cake, right? So this is a major chord. If we take this note, that is our third finger note, the note on the D string rather, that's our G sharp, and we move it down by one semitone, so we get 7, 5, and 4 on A, D, and G. We get a minor chord. Major chord, minor chord. The only difference here is that we have a major third here, a minor third or a flat third here, which is a semitone below where we are with our major third. So we have major chord, minor chord. If we keep going and we take this note down by yet another semitone, it becomes an F sharp. And here we get this lovely sounding series of notes. This is 7, 4, 4, and we'd refer to this as a Sus2 chord. This would be, in this case, E, F sharp, B. And we'd call this an E Sus2. Really nice sounding, very, very open, works great with effects. So if we throw a reverb and delay back on, very dreamy sounding chords. I'm sure you'll agree. We'll get to what makes them so in a minute. But we also need to define a Sus4, which we're also going to do... I guess we're going to define why it doesn't really matter which one we're using, because we'll get to that in a second. Now, Sus4, very, very quickly. If we take the same idea, we start with our major chord, but this time we take our third and move it up a semitone, we get a Sus4, which in this case would be E, A and B. Sus4, major, minor, Sus2. Dead easy. We can also demonstrate it down here with this classic D chord where we get this. There's a D chord. D sus4, D chord, D minor, D sus2. Get it rid of the D minor. We have 1,000 songs that use this typical D sort of thing. Now, here's an interesting thing though, right? Very quickly, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take this same chord that we played here. This is our E sus2. But let's just change it a little bit. This time what I wanna do is I wanna put the B on the bottom. So B is here, E is here, F sharp is here. Now, that could still be an E sus2, or it could be a B sus4. The reason for this is that sus2s and sus4s are inverse of each other. I'll say that again. Sus2s, sus4s, inverse of each other. B sus4 and E sus2 contain all of the same notes. So if I play this, or in fact, if I play this, it could be either. It could be a B sus4, or it could be an E sus2. The reason I bring this up is because you actually don't need to know both. Just one will do for what we're doing today. So in this case, we're going to focus our attention on sus2s. Now, everything we say with sus2 is also applicable to sus4. We'll get to that. But, you know, we're playing sus2s for the majority of what we're doing today. And the reason for that is going to be clear in just a second. Now, what I want you to do very quickly, I'm going to go back to this E thing. And we're going to do an experiment, right? I'm going to ask you, dear friend, to play me an E major chord. I'm going to count you off, 1, 2, 3, 4. While you play your E major chord, I'm going to play this E sus2. Let's try that together. 1, 2, 3, 4. Hopefully, what you would have noticed when we play that together is we get something that adds up to this, which is a really pretty sounding chord. Now, this chord in particular is an E add 9. Let's talk about what's going on there. See this extra note that we've thrown in here. Let's take an E very quickly. There's an E chord. There's an E. If we take our fourth finger, pop it onto fret number 4 on the D string, we get this shape. What have we added? We've added this F sharp note. And we established earlier on that this F sharp is the 2 in our sus2. So add 9, sus2 become kind of synonyms for each other. They're not exactly the same because a sus2 doesn't have a third in it and an add 9 does. But here's the fun thing. If you have a guitar player who's playing this and you play this over the top, you have added up between the two of you to an add 9 chord. So if you play sus2s, you can play them over major chords and they'll just come out sounding like add 9s. It's really lovely. It means we can take a chord progression that would run like this. And turn it into something like this. Which is very pretty. Also very pretty. Also very pretty. Now you can do that across your two guitars, but this is another fun thing we can do. We can also use that same approach to play arpeggios of our sus2s with total impunity over any major chord. Literally any major chord. You pick a major chord, you can play a sus2 on that chord. Why? Because it adds up to an add 9. So if we have a chord progression that runs E, B, A, B, very common, E, B, A, B, we can play E sus2, B sus2, A sus2. Now I'll show you how to play these in a second. We're going to get to that, right? We're going to get to that stuff, so fear not. Just showing you what's out there. Now, is it just major chords that we can play this stuff over? No, we can play it over minor chords too. So let's go back to the E example. I'm going to ask you, dear friend, once again, to play an E minor chord this time. You play an E minor, I'll play this sus2 over the top. I'm going to count you off on four. We're going to play together. Ready? One, two, three, four. Now, hopefully between the two of us, we generated a chord that sounded something like this. Again, really beautiful sound. What we've done is we've taken an E minor, we've laid an F sharp over the top, and we've generated an E minor add nine, add nine. So we can play our sus2 arpeggios over any major chord and over any minor chord and have them work. It's pretty cool, right? Pretty cool. So what you end up with is, instead of this, if we took C, D, E minor, we can then get this. Very, very pretty. That's the sound we get. Don't worry about playing these voicings exactly. We're going to explore that in just a minute. So let's talk about how you might use some of these, and we'll do some in the context. Welcome to the welcome home sanitarium chord. It sure is. It's so many songs, right? Use this. Why? Because it sounds pretty. It's all we need to know. Literally all we need to know. We take the same approach, we can get that. That famous chord progression is the every breath you take thing. It can become 7 days. Can it? Trying to remember these chords now, so on and so forth. Dominic Miller, what a guitar player. I remember playing that, by the way. We played Every Breath You Take in A flat because we had horns on my first ever band session in college. I was 16, and I was made to play that. Jeez, and admonished for not being able to do it. Not easy. Later found out that Andy Summers moves his first finger. Of course he does, because it's muted. Anyway, Daryl Queen's turned up. Daryl, it's good to see you, man. What you've missed, I'll sum up in 2 minutes. You can basically play a sus2 version of whatever chord you're on, whether it's major or minor. If you have a C major, you can play C sus2 over the top. If you have E minor, you can play E sus2 over the top. Piece of cake. Should have just said that, really. Would have saved ourselves loads of time, but I had to demonstrate. I had to take you on that little journey together. So, anyway, let's get into soloing land, and let's talk about how we might use some of these. So, we're going to go back to our big distortion tone. Wow, the amp is upset today. Making all sorts of strange noises. Don't know what's going on there. I think I accidentally engaged a pedal or some such similar device. So there's our big distortion tone, which we need for this, because of course we do. Why would we not? Let me show you some sus2 arpeggios that we might play and how we can use these in our soloing context. So very quickly, with the knowledge that we can play a sus2 on any major or minor chord, what we can use this, we can extrapolate this out to cover some of the conclusions we drew in our previous streams, which were that we could play... this is kind of fun, right? And this is going to be the big reveal, I think. We discussed in a previous stream how if you're in a given key, in this case, we're going to be playing something in E Dorian. So we're using the chords derived from D major. Don't worry about that. I'll tell you what they are. We can use any of the chords in a given key, and we can play any of them over any chord. So if I'm playing E minor in E Dorian, I can still play A major quite contentedly over the top. For example, is it against the rules? Nope, because there aren't any rules, but it works. We can then extrapolate it out from this and say that we could play any sus2 chord from any major or minor chord in our chord progression. What am I talking about? I'll reveal that to you in a second. It's not quite true. There is one minor chord where we have to be careful, but we'll get to that in a second. So very quickly, let me show you one that we can play together. This is a fun and fairly easy one, although it's a little bit stretchy. I'm going to show you what's going on here. So if we take a power chord, but this time we're going to play a power chord way up here. We're going to play D fret number 14, G fret number 16. And then on top, we'll play B fret number 17. So it's 14, 16, 17. There's a power chord for you guys, which we can advance down here. Anywhere we'd normally play a power chord, we can play that, right? I'm gonna show you two cool notes of the top. Chris Brown says the three chord, well, we have to be careful. You're 100% correct, and you know why as well, because it has a flat nine attached to it. So we need to be careful with that, but we'll get to that, right? But it's fun because we're starting to deduce where we can and can't use this sort of stuff. So let's take our power chord and let's expand this a little bit further, right? So we've got this. There's our power chord. We have root, fifth, root. If we play finger number one, on E, fret number 14. There, we have a sus2. Root third, sorry, root fifth, root two. Let's try playing that along with our backing track. So we're here, we're playing an E Dorian. This is our E Dorian big hair backing track, appropriate enough for me. Let's just play with this first of all, right? This is our first part of our sus2. I'm going to ask you to improvise me something using just those notes. You know what notes they are? This is your spot. Dead easy. We're going to add another note into the pool in a second, but let's take one more second to get used to that. Okay, you take a turn. Same deal. Then I'm going to show you one more note that can sling on top of this. All right. The note we're going to throw on top is going to be 19 on the high E. So we have 14, 19 on top. Don't need to shred with it, but you'll see that it's pretty easy to if you want to, right? We can go to town on this. Now this sounds cool, right? That's an E sus2. It works just fine over what it is that we're playing here. But it probably also looks a little bit familiar because this shape here, this shape that we've seen 1,000 times, this business. Oop. It looks an awful lot like the top of a pentatonic scale. Because it kind of is. So what if we were to take this same idea? There's an E sus2. Which we can shred to our heart's content. It's actually surprisingly easy. This is not a complicated fingering once you get your hands around it. There are more complex fingerings if you want them. My friend Craig says, calm down, Frank Gambale, the thunder from down under. You know what it is, right? A quick Frank Gambale tangent. I was so taken aback. Some people you meet, I get to meet a lot of cool people doing this gig, and it's a wonderful privilege. But like one of the people I met was, some of the people you meet are exactly the way they appear when you talk to them. So examples of that are, ooh, let's think. The one that's come to mind immediately is Lee Anden. Like Lee Anden is exactly the same as he is on camera. Just a really nice, fun guy. Steve Morse is another one like that. Really, really super cool. Steve Vai, same deal. One of the guys that really struck me as kind of interesting as the opposite. Sometimes you get people who have like an alter ego, I guess, an alter persona. And then we talk to them, they're like somebody kind of different, and it's not always bad. Was Frank Gambale. Like, Gambale comes off as this professorial, intellectual kind of guy, and he is. He's a fabulous musical mind. But when you talk to him and he's not like doing the teaching thing or doing the hey, buy my new Fusion album thing, he's just a really down-to-earth Aussie bloke. and swears like a trooper, and he's fantastic. And I'm like, wow, was not expecting that. Great dude. So anyway, how did we get to that? Oh yeah, Gambale. Yeah, I'm not fit to lace Frank's boots, but even still, we'll get there. So we're going to take the same shape very quickly, right? The same shape. Let's just move it down two frets. So what we get here is we have D, A, D again, E, high A. Fret numbers, 12 on the D string, 14 on the G string, 15 on the B string, 12, 17 on the high E. Exactly the same as before, but this should look a lot like the E minor pentatonic scale, because it's not a million miles off. Now, if we play just these two back to back, D sus2 and E sus2, bearing in mind we're playing an E Dorian here, we can get some cool results, right? So let's experiment. Let me show you the shapes once again. Now that sounds pretty cool, right? I'm gonna go a little quicker and then I'm gonna give you guys a pass. Shred aside, you take a turn with those two shapes, right? D sus2, E sus2. That is all we need, right? And already we're making wonderful sounding, wonderful's maybe not the word, but we're making cool sounding stuff. Now, what you'll find with this is you start to hear this crop up in the playing of lots of players that you really admire. So you might hear like an Eric Johnson thing. You take a turn, same deal, a little bit of a pentatonic diversion there, but you get the idea. This stuff doesn't have to exist in vacuums. It's best when you blend it with the existing stuff that you already know how to do. So let's back out of there, right? Let's continue this logic for a minute. So what we've got is we have an E sus2, a D sus2. What about other ones we can play? Well, let's talk about the chords that are available to us in our Dorian pool. So Dorian's drawing in this case from the chords from D major. So we have a D major, an E minor. We've already played sus2s on both of those. We played a D sus2, an E sus2. F sharp we have to be careful with, so we're going to sidestep that for just a second. But we can also play G and A. Those are two major chords that appear in D major, and they also add up in our Dorian. So if we play Dorian, you've heard that progression 1,000 times, right? You've heard me play it along with it today. Well, what about if we had a G sus2 and an A sus2? Where are we gonna find them? Well, let's go looking. First of all, E, D, A. There's a G. So what do we got? We got G sus2, A sus2, D sus2, E sus2. Don't we sound like grown-up guitar players? Well, all we're doing is this. But breaking it up like this. Same shape. This shape here, this shape here, this shape here, this shape here. If that pinky finger is a stretch, don't play it. Do this. Let's try it together. Here we go. Daryl Queen, interesting one. I have in my head that the four is usually an avoid note. Well, it depends. There are no wrong notes. Maybe sometimes we just lack the confidence to play them. Anyway, let me show you what I'm talking about. So let's start with G and A. take a turn. Take as long as you need. There's a G. There's an A. There's a D. There's an E. I'm gonna go like this. Take a turn, got a bit cheeky there, went off on some single octave stuff, which I'm going to show you in a second. We'll get to that. So you take a turn. You take a turn. I'm going to go one more time. Got to apologize for the nonsense with some blues sometimes, but you take a pass. Again, I'm playing some notes here because I've been making a flipping album and I'm just happy to be playing notes again. So we're going to get out of that. So that is a little bit of a look at how we might use this with one particular shape. We've got some really great comments here. Robert Fripp-ish at times with those wide intervals. For sure. Now, it's a really ear-catching sound, but it doesn't sound out per se, because it's not. It just kind of sounds like the way other instruments tend to play this stuff, for example. Oh, here's a really cool comment from Mike Seedorf. Frank Gambale, Don Mock, Scott Henderson, Paul Gilbert, Danny Gill, etc. were all instructors at GIT in 86 when I was there. Oh my goodness, man, what a dream team. That's pretty incredible. And our very own Danny Gill. Danny's the man, literally the coolest guy. Anyway, so listen, we got a little bit out into shred world there, so let's back it out a wee bit and let's talk a little bit more about some smaller applications for these. So I wanted to give you the big picture stuff here, but here's a fun way that we can use a Sus2 as a little unit that we can play within our own playing. So or within the phrases that we already know how to play. So we talked about this in our Richie Kotzen streams before. We talked about the Richie Kotzen rudiment. Now, the Richie Kotzen rudiment is, in its essence, a Sus2 most of the time. But what a Sus2 might look like, if we took a D note, right? If we take this D Sus2 shape that we had up here, we'll talk about the notes that we've got in here. We've got a D, we've got an A, we've got a D again, we've got an E, and then a high A. So the only unique notes are D, E, and A. What about if we played here? D, E, A. That makes sense? D, E, A. Fret numbers, 10, 12 on the low E string, 12 again. Now that's cool, we like that. Played it up an octave. There's a D note. 12, 14, 14. That sounds pretty cool. Let's throw that on with our backing track. Let's just play some phrases with that. I really like that. That sounds fantastic. Does it look and sound like the minor pentatonic scale? Yes. Why? Because it's in the minor pentatonic scale. Hooray! But it doesn't sound like this. And there's nothing wrong with that, but sometimes you want this. That sounds really cool. Are there other places we can find this in our minor pentatonic scale? Well, yeah, because there's loads of places that we have this same shape. We have this business here, where we have essentially a 2-fret gap and then the same note as our third finger mirrored up a string. Well, where are we getting them? Let's find a few. We could play it off this D note here. We could play it off this G note here. We can play it off this A note here. Then up this D note. We can play it here. Adjusting for the scale. 12, 14, 15. We can play it up another fret here on A. We can play it again here. D. We can play it off the E. anywhere you find this shape, you have a sus2, which is super cool because it basically gives us something that we already know how to play, which is our minor pentatonic scale, which sounds like this currently. Which is very cool, sounds great. But we can turn it into this. That's pretty quick, so let's phrase it. That sounds fantastic. Take a turn. You take a pass. I'm gonna go again. You take another turn, again. Getting off into the weeds here, but it's just kind of showing you guys, because we've got players of all different levels here. We've got shredders, we've got guys who are, shred curious. We've got guys who have no interest in that stuff at all. Just want to show you guys what it's like at different kind of paces, etc., etc., etc. And then I'm going to give you one more cool shape. All right. Here's one more fun shape for you guys. Now, this is one a little bit more for the shred guys, I guess, for the quick players out there. I'm gonna take this arpeggio shape very quickly. This is a really common arpeggio shape that we played loads of times. It's our E major arpeggios. This is one we can kook with. We can absolutely burn with this stuff. So this is our... Daryl Queen's got a question. Inverted power chord, basically almost, but not quite. We'll get to that. I'll show you another way to pick this up. It's like two power chords stacked on top of each other. So anyway, there's our classic Common Old Garden E major sweep shape. Watch this, right? Take this high note on the low E string, and also on the high E string, move it down a tone. So instead of this, we get this. Bar across, instead of playing here, well, we'll leave that for now. That sounds pretty cool. Take this note, pop it here. So what we get instead is we get 12, 14, 14 on the A string, 14 on the D string, 11 on the G string, 12, 12, 14. You can kook with it. Absolutely go crazy with that shape. There's an A version that's the same. I encourage you to do the same. I encourage you to go and look for it. Basically, it kind of looks like this. But because it's the same shape, we can play the same shape on major or minor chords, like, regardless. We can just go absolutely bonkers with this stuff and get some very cool Gambale-esque nonsense, which might be... that sort of thing. You wonder where those licks come from, these, like, what even is that kind of licks. A lot of them is this. Certainly Frank's playing. A lot of it is that sus2 thing. Now, I realize this is way off into the shred weeds, but it's fun to get in this sort of spot every once in a while. But that is not to say that this stuff is out of the... the bounds of usefulness for players that aren't into the shred thing. We discussed how you can phrase with this stuff. It's man destroyed us in 10 seconds. I played every note that I know in 10 seconds. I try not to break that stuff out too much in the stream because it's totally over the top. And my playing's already over the top. So I said so on the name of the licks package. But that's hilarious. Thanks, man. I appreciate that. Shades of Marty Friedman, too, says Daryl Queen. For sure. Like, you hear this stuff in Marty's playing, you hear it with a slightly different aesthetic in Eric Johnson's playing, we hear it in Frank Gambale's, we hear it in Andy Summers' chord choices. It's really interesting, right? And then my friend Craig's absolutely got it right. Once you get it under your fingers, it's fun to let rip. Totally is, because you don't need to change shapes. You play the same shape. It's like when you first learn a power chord, you just move it around and go bash, 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 bash. This is great. This is great. This is great. This is great. It's exactly the same thing, but it's almost like sweeping on easy mode, if that makes sense, because we can just play the same shape. Again, I'm going to encourage you guys to look for those shapes because they're really good fun. You'll find one that works for you and is really, really easy. But it's very good. It's very good fun, and we can tap with it as well. We'll get to that another time. Anyway, so we'll get back to this shred thing. So I want to answer this question from Daryl Queen because he's kind of got it, right? Which is this idea that it's basically an inverted power chord. It's kind of an inverted power chord in shape, but what you might think about it as is you might think about it as a power chord like this. I've got the close-up cam. A power chord. And then a power chord on top of the power chord. I've heard John Petrucci play this stuff all the time. It's that Now, the cool thing about this is the same substitution principles that we talked about of, you know, this can be a major chord, it can be a minor chord. They apply with the chord playing too. So you might think about it as that. And if you want to play it with the notes on the line, all you've got to do is take this note that we've added, the power chord on top of the power chord, and drop that by one octave to here, like this. And away we go with, you know, all of that kind of good stuff. All that good stuff. Our Dream Theater blockers. I don't know that they are, you know. I don't know that they are. Mustache Metals, JP used exactly this idea for the Glasgow Kiss intro, for sure. Do you know, because, why? Because it sounds great. It's just really, really good. So anyway, listen, we're going to go to the Q&A, because we've got some great questions. We've got some discussion about modelers that I want to get into. Hopefully you guys have found that useful. If you want to know a little bit more about this sort of thing, then we've got a great course for you mastering modes that you might want to check out. But, more importantly, if you want to get better at the old shred thing, because the shred thing's interesting, we've got a fantastic course called Picking Strategies Part 1. Part 2 is coming with more sweep picking stuff in it, because sweep picking is fun, but we just need to get it made. But it is coming, believe me. This is Picking Strategies Part 1. You want to get good at picking, this is a place to start, and it's available as part of your GI Plus subscription. When we come back, we'll be answering your questions.
Does your picking feel uncoordinated and sometimes you miss notes or fluff transitions from string to string, maybe a little bit like this? When in reality what you want is smooth and easy and transparent feeling picking, a bit like this. Or maybe you've been sold on the idea that there's one specific way that you have to pick on the guitar and everything else is wrong, but that particular cookie cutter approach just doesn't work for you. It feels unnatural. It almost feels like you're fighting your own body to try and make it work. Well, Picking Strategies Part 1 is the course for you. In this course, we explore the many different ways that you can form a full and complete and comprehensive picking approach by examining the various strategies used by some of the greatest pickers of all time. And there are a whole bunch of strategies out there, and I guarantee there is one that is going to work for your preferred picking mechanics, the way you prefer to stand or sit with the guitar, the type of guitar you play, the type of music you play. There is a strategy for you. We're going to explore all of them, and I'm going to show you how you can take a single solo study and play every line within it using all of the six picking strategies that we look at in this course. And of course, this entire course is available as part of your GI Plus membership. So if you're not signed up already, what better excuse do you need to sign up today?
I'm sure you probably caught some cheeky Sus2 arpeggios going on in that demonstration. Now that you know what you're looking for, you'll spot them all. I play them all the time, right? There's so much fun because they're just so simple. Once you get your fingers under them, right, and they're just wonderful. I love it. Absolutely love it. Absolutely love it. So anyway, we've got some fabulous comments coming. You guys are far too kind. I'm not going to stroke my own ego by sharing them, but thank you so much. I do appreciate it, right? I appreciate you humoring me with the shred stuff because I love it. And I'm not going to say I don't get to do it often enough. I do, but I try not to do it all the time because I realize it's not everyone's cup of tea. And you know, we like to be rounded musicians and play all sorts of stuff that's, you know, who am I kidding? Shred's fantastic. Anyway, listen, so I want to talk a little bit about this, right? So this is discussion of modelers. So Steve McDee says, I'm wondering if I really need an FRFR speaker to go with my new modeler. I'm plugging into any old PA when playing out, so does FRFR really matter? Well, the question there is kind of self-answering, I guess, because if you're plugging into any old PA and you're happy with the way it sounds, then probably not, realistically. However, what I would recommend is it's always worth having something, if you're doing the modeling thing, it's always worth having something that you can maybe take in the car with you and pull out when it's, you know, in case the monitoring is not working. So, you know, let's say you don't have a monitor, you turn up to a gig, there's no monitor for you, or you can't hear the PA system, or, you know, it just sounds terrible in soundcheck. For whatever reason, the engineer has the monitors dialed in such a way that it's just awful. You often find this with monitors that are dialed to flatter a vocal. They'll tend to sound quite harsh with a guitar. This is troublesome for me as a guitar player vocalist, because I want the flattering on the vocal, and I also want the guitar to sound nice. Best of luck with that. But never mind. So to be honest, for that, I just kind of deal with the guitar sound. I'm like, it's fine. As long as the vocal sounds good, we're happy. But I would recommend maybe having just a small PA speaker. Would be my first port of call. However, I'm going to show some love to our friends over at Laney, because they make some unbelievably good FRFL speakers that are dirt cheap. So what I've been doing recently is I have a very good front house engineer who's very generous with his equipment and always brings me two really nice monitors. And what I've noticed is the gigs where I have, because I use in-ears as well, right? So I use in-ears too. So it's not just the monitor I'm listening for, but the way I tend to do it is I tend to have, it's kind of sound kind of egotistical, but I have what the band laughingly call the John Mayer setup, where I have the in-ears for my needs to hears. So I have a little bit of guitar, normally a hi-hat mic, sometimes kick and snare. I have a little bit of the other guitar and a lot of my own vocal in the in-ears, but the majority of my guitar sound comes from the wedges that are in front of me on the stage. The reason being is that I like the feeling of power that we get from having a loud guitar on stage. I like the way it feels. It makes me play a little more confidently, I guess, or maybe play a little less reservedly. That's always handy, I think, and that comes from having a consistent monitoring setup. I couldn't tell you what brand they are. I know they're quite expensive, and I wouldn't encourage you to go out and buy them. What I'm getting at with this is that if I didn't have those lovely monitors at my disposal, I'd probably be reaching for something like the Laney FRFR stuff, just to have near me and have the sensation of the guitar kind of wafting at me, because I have noticed a difference. I mean, when I'm using ears, it sounds great, but it doesn't feel quite the same. I feel very under the microscope. I have to constantly remind myself that the audience can't hear what I can hear. But, you know, if you're happy with the tone, it doesn't really matter. You've kind of answered the question. As far as playing at home, here's a good one. David Yates is asking, what do I use in terms of computer monitors? I have a pair of Atom, because my room is the room I'm playing in is not a huge room. So I have a pair of Atom T5Vs, I want to say, or TV5s, not sure what it is. Little Atom monitors with the ribbon tweeter. I feel like the ribbon tweeter makes a big difference because it's very unfatiguing. However, when I'm playing, I spend most of my time playing through these. These are a set of... but I'm going to try and show it up to the main camera so you guys can see. I have to cover my face, though, because Sony, there you go. A set of Beyerdynamic DT1990 Pros. And they're a set of high-end or higher-end open-back headphones. They sound fabulous. I do a lot of my mixing work on those, too, because I've kind of gotten used to mixing on headphones, and I'll reference some other things. We'll get into mixing another time. We'll talk about... we'll maybe do a stream on mixing guitars. We'll get to that, because that's something I'm interested in. But hopefully, that is something that is... that's kind of useful as far as the FRFR discussion goes. Long story short, if you want consistent FRFR stuff, there's some really good stuff out there. A small PA speaker that you're familiar with and have dialed your sound through is a good way to go, or Laney is a good way to go. They make some fabulous speakers. Guthrie's using them now, which is crazy, right? And if it's good enough for Guthrie, good enough for us. And they're quite cheap. My friend Craig says, Jesus, just noticed you're super tan, mate. Dude, I can tan in a dark room, right? But it's been so hot. I haven't been anywhere. I haven't been on holiday or anything. I've just been in my garden and I've gone this color. It's not even funny. So that's that distant Grecian thing, I guess. But yeah, anyway, we've got some more comments on the FRFR stuff. Some cool stuff. Monitoring, modeling, and in-ear monitoring is my favorite setup. Me too. The reason for this, and I'm guessing you have the same thing, is it's easy to travel with and it's consistent. Sorry, modeler and in-ear setup. Totally agree with you. Even if I'm have ears on stage, so when I travel with Blitzkrieg, we all use ears. Same with the Saints, same with all my bands. We use ears, but Brian the singer is old school. He likes to have monitors on stage, so we have a balanced mix of all of the instruments and his vocal across the front of the stage. So wherever he is with his microphone, he has about the same balance. So I've always got a bit of like kind of rock and roll from the guitar coming back at me, if that makes sense. So yeah, totally with you. But I can deal with just ears, it's fine. I just feel a little bit more... I guess a little more reserved with that sort of stuff. Response Audio has a great question. Says, the thumb on my picking hand is double jointed and goes way back, and my grip suffers compared to other players I know. Well, think about the picking course. I'm sure there are some tips in there. I would say with this, there will be a way that you can hold the pick that will work just fine for you. What you might experiment with is a trailing edge picking style, where instead of the... I don't have a brightly colored pick with me. I would normally have my passport down there for no good reason. It's just hanging out there. But I'm looking for pick-shaped things I could play with. Basically, the gist of it is, instead of having this kind of picking angle where the thumb side of the pick is pointing towards the floor, you can experiment with this, which is a trailing edge style, where you have the thumb side of the pick pointing upwards. Players who have had success with this include George Benson, who has a very full developed picking technique. Rabia Massad is a guy who has a very notable trailing edge technique, especially on his riffing sort of stuff. It's something worth experimenting with, but what I would say with this is don't let that sort of morphology thing get the best of you. Now, the way the picking course works is it's more of an exploratory course. And what we do is we propose six models for... or six strategies, if you want to call it that, for which is what we call them, for picking approaches. And I guide you through each one, but with the idea that you don't use all six. You don't use all six. You discover which one of the six fits your existing technique. if that makes sense. So you may find if that's something that you tend to prefer, that often goes hand in hand with a single escape, upstroke escape picking style, which is kind of like the Eric Johnson, Zach Wilde style, but with the notable exception that the picking edge has changed. But it can definitely work, right? So for me, for example, I have double jointed pinky fingers and double jointed thumbs, but I have double jointed thumbs at this joint, which is kind of weird. So I end up with these perfectly straight thumbs that cause a whole lot of hilarity with the band. Like they think that's hilarious for some reason. This thumb has a lot more mobility in this joint than this thumb does, which is a little weird. I also have a big pronounced bend in this finger from a basketball incident when I was a kid, but that's neither here nor there. And I also think, you know, playing with just these three fingers, doing the Andy James hand a lot when I was young, probably did that too. So anyway, listen guys, we've run out of time, as we always do. Thank you so much for tuning in. We are of course here every Monday. If you want to help us keep the lights on, go check out some of the courses that are available on GI Plus. I'm going to bid you guys adieu and play some more shreddy stuff, I guess, because why not. So the backing track is available on the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel. It is the Dorian Big Hair backing track. Search Dorian Big Hair backing Guitar Interactive, you will find it. It's available free, also available on GI Plus at the link right here or in the description below this video. My name is Nick Jennison. Happy shredding. Don't feel like you have to shred with this stuff. You can use these sort of ideas for all manner of cool stuff, but shred is but one of those things. Anyway, in the meantime, gonna play some notes. I'll see you guys next week. Take care of yourselves. Bye for now. See you guys next week. Take care of yourselves. Bye for now. My name is Nick Jennison, and it's a pleasure to introduce to you GI Plus, the brand new lesson platform brought to you by Guitar Interactive. We've assembled a team of the best players and educators in the world to bring you exclusive lessons covering everything from metal to blues to fusion and everything in between. Want to level up your shred chops? Check out How to Play Fast by Andy James. Or how about Sweet Picking with Rick Graham? Or maybe country's more your bag? Well, how about a full-length exclusive country guitar course from Andy Wood? Interested in learning how to play over changes? Well, members get access to hours of exclusive lessons from fusion maestro Tom Quayle. Or maybe you want your playing to sound more soulful? Well, who better than Chris Buck to show you how it's done? Or perhaps you want to learn the secrets of the masters? Well, members get access to over 60 feature-length tech sessions where our tutors painstakingly decode the styles of players like David Gilmour, Eddie Van Halen, John Petrucci, Larry Carlton, Slash, Tolson Abassi, Paul Gilbert, and many more.
You get all this along with exclusive live webinars, free backing tracks, competitions, and so much more. So what are you waiting for? Sign up for GI Plus today.